Calorama, a Recorded Books Highbridge imprint, presents The Enemy Within: How a Totalitarian Movement is Destroying America, by David Horowitz. Read by Rick Adamson. At what point, then, is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer, if it ever reach us, it must spring up amongst us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we must ourselves be its author and finisher. As a nation of freemen, we must live through all time or die by suicide. Abraham Lincoln, Lyceum Address. We are not carrying out war against individuals. We are exterminating the bourgeoisie as a class. We are not looking for evidence or witnesses to reveal deeds or words against the Soviet power. The first question we ask is, to what class does he belong? What are his origins, upbringing, education, or profession? These questions define the fate of the accused. This is the essence of the Red Terror. Cheka official during the time of Lenin. Part 1. Foundations. Chapter 1. White Male Christians. Americans are more divided today than at any time since the Civil War. So deep and intractable are the divisions that our most fundamental rights to religious liberty, freedom of speech, and the presumption of innocence until proven guilty are under relentless attack. We can no longer even agree on so basic a principle as the need for a legal immigration process to protect our sovereignty and civic culture. Even more ominously, we cannot count on the commitment of one of our major political parties to honor the results of a presidential election or adhere to the rules that prevent election fraud. The two parties are now guided by overlooks so divergent that their supporters seem to inhabit alternative universes. For 4 years, slander has been a weapon of first resort for the resistance to President Trump. Its goal, his removal from office by any means available. This is a political agenda at odds with the core premise of our democratic system, which was designed by the founders to promote compromise and mutual respect. The effect of the anti-Trump obsession and the strategy of obstruction has been to deepen conflicts and make them all but unresolvable. Another casualty of the Democrats' resistance has been patriotic loyalty, which is now suspect as loyalty to white nationalism and white supremacy. The presentation of a common front to America's enemies and the idea that politics stops at the water's edge were once hallmarks of a loyal opposition, but they have been cast aside by Democrats bent on sabotaging Trump's presidency, regardless of the effects of their defection on America's national security. In the course of the anti-Trump wars, we have become two nations with little shared ground on the core issues that previously defined us, whether individuals should be judged on their merits or on the basis of their skin color, gender, and sexual orientation, whether resistance to a duly elected government is compatible with a democratic society or a dagger aimed at its heart. The source of these divisions is a reactionary ideology, usually referred to as identity politics, which has engulfed the Democrat Party and undermined its liberal instincts. It is an ideology that is racial and collectivist, that privileges groups over individuals, and demonizes those who fall on the wrong side of its social equations. As a worldview, identity politics is fundamentally at odds with America's core principles of individual freedom, accountability, and equality, which have been the foundation of the nation's progress for more than 200 years. Identity politics is often referred to as political correctness, but it is more accurately understood as cultural Marxism. The idea that American society is characterized by oppressive hierarchies and thus divided into warring races, genders, and classes. Political correctness is a term that describes a left-wing party line. It was coined by the mass murderer Mao Zedong in the 1930s to keep his followers under the heel of the Chinese Communist Party. Adherents of the Progressive Party line today regard white Americans, males, Christians, and Jews as oppressors, enemies, and themselves as warriors for social justice. The Communist Origins of Identity Politics. According to Wikipedia, the phrase identity politics first appeared in a 1978 manifesto written by self-described black feminist revolutionaries who were members of the Combahee River Collective. The manifesto proclaimed their unalterable hostility to the American system, black women's extremely negative relationship to the American political system, a system of white male rule, has always been determined by our membership in two oppressed racial and sexual castes. Focusing upon our own oppression is embodied in the concept of identity politics. We believe that the most profound and potentially most radical politics come directly out of our own identity. Citing their debt to lifelong communist apparatchik Angela Davis, the Combahee radicals paid homage in their manifesto to the Marxist roots of their outlook and its anti-American agenda. We realize that the liberation of all oppressed peoples necessitates the destruction of the political economic systems of capitalism and imperialism, as well as patriarchy. In other words, identity politics originated as an anti-American Marxist ideology dedicated to America's destruction. Identity politics is a totalitarian ideology that depicts all aspects of human activity, down to the use of pronouns, as political, therefore requiring management and control. It erases individuals by assigning them to categories that ignore their particular circumstances, achievements, failures, and choices. Individuals are judged first and foremost on the basis of their race, gender, and sexual orientation. These categories take precedence over their individual origins, attitudes, and achievements. Modern progressivism, which embraces cultural Marxism, is a reactionary movement whose goal is to return to the status societies of the pre-capitalist era, when individuals were born into an unalterable hierarchy ranging from peasant to aristocrat. This was the situation that existed before the revolutions of the 18th century created liberal democracies with their concept of individual freedom and their opportunities for upward mobility facilitated by market capitalism. Identity politics is based on the false premise that America is a society in which people are consigned to castes that define their roles and stamp them for life. In reality, the opposite is true. America is the most upwardly mobile society in human history. All its citizens are afforded the right to climb the ladder of opportunity and also to fall from its economic and social heights. Identity politics is a collectivist ideology that is the antithesis of America's self-conception and aspiration since its founding, the belief that individuals are created equal and are to be judged on their merits, not by their origin or other unalterable characteristics. Identity politics ignores the dedication and sacrifices that millions of Americans of all races and genders have made to defend the principles of created equal and born free. It also ignores the actual American achievement, the creation, through two centuries of struggle, of a nation that is today the most inclusive and tolerant, multi-ethnic and multi-racial society in human history. The racist premise of the progressive left. In one form or another, identity politics now forms the core conviction of America's political progressives and the Democrat Party. Its reactionary outlook was recently on display in an ABC News column by Matthew Dowd, a sometime Republican, current Democrat, and charter member of the Washington establishment. Dowd's column appeared, not coincidentally, 2 days after the conclusion of a ferocious party-line battle over the Supreme Court nomination of Justice Brett Kavanaugh, in which identity politics played an ugly and defining role. The headline of Dowd's column was a summation of its thesis, "Us white male Christians need to step back and give others room to lead." In normal times, the transparent bigotry of this remark and the agenda being pushed in his column would have been sufficient to make American hairs stand on end. But bigotry on behalf of groups that are designated victims of oppression has become so ingrained in the politics of the left and so influential in the political culture at large that Dowd's comment passed unnoticed. In Dowd's view, which is the view of leftists generally, what is wrong with America is that there are too many white males, white Christian males, occupying positions of power and influence, and allegedly keeping diverse, marginalized, and underserved minorities in their place. The very idea that blacks are marginalized is absurd. They are obviously front and center in America's culture and consciousness, as well as in the distribution of race-based privileges and benefactions. Recognizing these facts is not to deny that a significant minority segment of the black population is poor and lives at the social margins, but skin color can hardly be an explanation for their plight when the majority of black Americans are comfortably in the middle class and better off than the populations of any black-run society on earth. The view that blacks still suffer systemic racist oppression in America, that in order to advance they need white elites to step back, is a fiction that provides an excuse for failure, while also imbuing social justice advocates with a false sense of moral superiority. The Matthew Dowds of the world assume the posture of soldiers against injustice, which leads them to condemn not only the American present, but the American founding and its framework of individual freedom. Progressives dismiss the creation of America as the malicious work of slave-owning white Christian males. This is an incitement to dismantle the most successful project in creating a multiracial, multi-ethnic society on record. It is also historically false. White Christian males were responsible for the first moral condemnation of slavery in world history. And the founding generation pioneered the abolition of slavery in the Western Hemisphere and created a political framework that laid the groundwork for the integration of all Americans in a diverse polity with equal rights for all citizens regardless of creed or color. Unfortunately, the attack on these ideas and this legacy is now the core curriculum of America's schools and the reigning bias of its popular culture, thanks to the dominant presence of leftists in the nation's teaching professions, entertainment industry, tax-exempt advocacy culture, and media. Even though America is an electoral democracy whose constitution guarantees that the rights of any citizen are equal to the rights of any other, progressives believe, and believe passionately, that America is actually governed by racial and gender hierarchies that keep non-white, non-male citizens down. These hierarchies are said to oppress minorities and exclude them from rising by means of glass ceilings and other invisible barriers erected by a white male patriarchy to keep them marginalized and subordinate. These claims are as factually baseless and politically destructive as the Marxist ideas that inspired them. Nothing could constitute a more direct assault on America's founding principles, which regard every citizen as unique, equal before the law, and accountable for himself. Is it actually the case that whites stand in the way of blacks and women? That white males need to step back to make room for others to solve the nation's problems? These are peculiar claims about a democracy in which women and minorities constitute a majority of the population, and thanks to the patriarchal founders and subsequent male majorities, are constitutionally guaranteed rights identical to those of other citizens, whites and males included. They are even more peculiar coming on the heels of an 8-year presidency whose chief executive, Barack Obama, National Security Chief Susan Rice, and Chief Law Enforcement Officers Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch, along with thousands of elected officials at the national, state, and local levels, were all Black Americans. Among the women and Blacks who have administered America's foreign policy as secretaries of state in the last 2 decades are Colin Powell, Condoleezza Rice, Madeleine Albright, and Hillary Clinton. As a measure of this achievement, consider that there is not a single majority Black or Brown or Asian nation in the world that has elected a white president, made a white person its chief law enforcement authority, or entrusted one with its national security and foreign policy. To justify his hostility to white Christian males and America's founding principles, Matthew Dowd offered this sweeping, historically illiterate statement. In the great span of world history, nearly all change and progress has come from an underserved and out-of-power group pushing, prodding, and pounding on those who hold power to expand it to include a wider and more diverse population. These are clichés of the left, commonly deployed to energize its troops. However, few statements so brief in nature can be said to contain so many obvious falsehoods. Factually speaking, the opposite is nearer to the truth. In the great span of world history, virtually all civilizational advances and social progress have been the work of groups that were already socially powerful and that shared ethnicity, religion, and gender with the ruling groups they overthrew. The forces of progress have generally not been what Dowd describes as underserved or representatives of a more diverse population. In the West, unquestionably the greatest social progress of the last 250 years has been the creation of liberal societies that support the principles of individual liberty, equality, tolerance, and inclusion. The groundwork of liberty was laid by documents like Magna Carta, which was the work of a group that belonged to the same social stratum as the authority whose power it curtailed, white, Christian, male, and aristocratic. The general progress of liberty was advanced by England and America, majority white Christian nations that led the world in abolishing the 3,000-year-old institution of slavery, which is still practiced in Black and Muslim Africa today. This progress was made possible by principles and actions that originally were entirely the work of white Christian males who were under no pressure from diverse, underserved, and out-of-power groups to do what they did. There were no successful slave revolts in the United States. Once slavery was abolished by white males, freed Black Americans spearheaded a civil rights movement that eventually ended segregation and institutional discrimination. But they did so in an indispensable alliance with white Americans, who put their lives on the line and provided the financial and political support that made it possible to overthrow the Southern regime of segregation and Jim Crow. The U.S. Constitution does not contain the words white, Black, male, or female, precisely because the founders believed they were creating a society in which equality would eventually prevail. It took nearly 200 years, hundreds of thousands of lives, and the greatest social revolution in history to bring about the changes necessary to realize that dream. It is a grim irony, therefore, that for the last 50 years, so-called progressives and the Democrat Party, which claims to represent underrepresented and diverse communities, have been working to turn back this clock and reverse the gains of the civil rights movement by introducing racial and gender categories and quotas into virtually every aspect of social life, from college admissions to job applications to positions on the United States Supreme Court. It is this regressive attack on America's fundamental principles by the left that is the source of the irreconcilable conflicts and ugly passions that are currently tearing the nation's fabric apart, and that is the subject of this book. Chapter 2. An Anti-American Creed. Karl Marx was intent on fomenting war between economic classes. Cultural Marxists have expanded the scope of his target to races, genders, and religious Christians. Identity politics, or cultural Marxism, has been the core curriculum of American public and private schools for several generations now. To distance themselves from the communist atrocities they made possible, and to absolve their ideas from responsibility for the catastrophic results, radicals have changed the name of their utopia to social justice. But their political mission, civil war in pursuit of a totalitarian ambition to remake the world and dominate its inhabitants, remains the same. Every university ethnic and gender studies program created in the last 60 years is based on the discredited Marxist model of oppression, a model that portrays American democracy as a sham designed to obscure the reality of domination and control. All these academic studies programs promote the belief that races and genders are not biologically grounded, but socially constructed, and thus open to revision and repair by revolutionary parties backed by the power of the state. All the ethnic and gender-oriented academic fields frame their subjects as victims of oppression, with one exception, the field of whiteness studies, which is devoted to the proposition that whiteness is evil and needs to be abolished. The racist perspective of the whiteness studies field was summarized in these self-abasing terms by Jeff Hitchcock, executive director of the Center of the Study of White American Culture at the Third National Conference on Whiteness held in 1998. There is no crime that whiteness has not committed against people of color. There is no crime that we have not committed even against ourselves. We must blame whiteness for the continuing patterns today that deny the rights of those outside of whiteness and which damage and pervert the humanity of those of us within it. This is obviously not a framework for scholarly inquiry, but a political diatribe that is both historically ignorant and bigoted. White people have created a civilization that abolished slavery, gave minority populations unprecedented opportunities, afforded women equal rights, and set standards of civil behavior that benefit all. Despite this, a pioneer publication of the academic movement of whiteness studies, the magazine Race Traitor, edited by Harvard faculty who were also members of the Communist Party, featured this motto: "Treason to whiteness is loyalty to humanity." What began in the 1970s as a racist movement directed against whites by fringe leftists in the academy has now become a central organizing theme of the progressive left and the leadership of the Democrat Party. Today, it is so powerful an ideology that it has spawned indictments of the president and his supporters and of America itself as white supremacist, a perfectly ludicrous charge. What could be a more baseless slander when applied to the most inclusive and tolerant nation in the world 60 years after the passage of the Civil Rights Acts and in the wake of the election and re-election of a black president whose margin of victory was secured by white majorities? An oppression curriculum. The sign of the whiteness movement's success has been the insertion of its anti-white, anti-male, anti-Christian bigotries into the curricula of the nation's K-12 schools, both public and private. One of many left-wing organizations involved in this sinister effort is Just Communities, which operates in 13 states. The following chart is taken from a K-12 curriculum provided by Just Communities called Forms of Oppression. This curriculum was authorized and underwritten with a budget of $1 million by the Democrat-run Santa Barbara, California School District. There are many similar curricula and teacher resources for K through 12 students available at internet sites such as the Orwellian tolerance.org. Those sites promulgate racist stereotypes about so-called white oppressors, emphasizing the invisibility of white racism and privilege, while describing it, absurdly and without evidence, as systemic. Form of oppression? Sexism. Privileged oppressor group? Men. Target victim group? Women. Form of oppression? Racism. Privileged oppressor group? White people. Target victim group? People of color. Form of oppression? Heterosexism. Privileged oppressor group? Heterosexual people. Target victim group? LGBTQ people. Form of oppression? Classism. Privileged oppressor group? Wealthy people. Target victim group? Working class and poor. Form of oppression? Religious oppression. Privileged oppressor group? Christian people. Target victim group? All others. This slanderous list imposed on school children is designed to incite feelings of envy, resentment, and outright hatred towards the targeted oppressor groups, regardless of what the individuals who compose them think or actually do in their lives. It is the antithesis of the principles enshrined in America's Declaration of Independence and Constitution. But that is the totalitarian point of blaming alleged structures of oppression for individual behaviors, rather than judging the individual behaviors themselves. The focus is always on the imaginary structures and away from the specific acts of individuals who are effectively erased. It is a morality play in which people are damned by their race, gender, religion, and economic status before they have committed a single act. It is also a vision in which the social order is a zero-sum game, where the deficits of individuals belonging to one social group are alleged, without evidence, to be caused by the successes of another. This is a destructive lie, designed to create envy, resentment, and hatred towards individual members of the target groups. For example, Christian males like Bill Gates, whose immense wealth is actually made possible only by Gates's successful efforts that created jobs and wealth for millions of others on a global scale. A leading academic figure in formulating the left's oppression perspective and inciting hatred of racial and gender groups was the late University of Chicago feminist professor Iris Marion Young. Her seminal book, Five Faces of Oppression, is based on the collectivist idea that concepts of justice should not be applied to individual actions and deserts. According to Young, membership in a social group is the primary factor in establishing what is just and what is not. This membership is essential to addressing structural inequalities because social rules and institutions allegedly constrain individuals as a group. This is collectivism run wild. It is an unreconstructed Marxism refuted by the millions of individuals who rise every day out of circumstances that might be expected to constrain and disadvantage them and succeed. The cultural Marxism pervasive in America's K-12 schools teaches students to view their social environment as a world divided between black and white, good and evil, oppressed and oppressor. It is a totalitarian vision that actively suppresses such vital bourgeois principles as individual responsibility, accountability, and freedom. Although the curriculum cited has been simplified by its creators for teenagers, it is an accurate guide to the attitudes of progressives at all levels of authority, achievement, and sophistication. Its crass bigotry, simple-minded ideas, and general lack of touch with reality can be gauged by its description of Christians as the sole religious oppressors of all other religions, who are described as their victims. The victim groups evidently include Muslims who have recently slaughtered over 500,000 Christians and Yazidis and other non-Muslims solely for the crime of having different religious beliefs. and atheists who, acting as communists and Nazis, murdered millions for their ethnicity and religious faith. In the eyes of the progressive left, Christians are responsible for white civilization with all its alleged iniquities bared and its miraculous achievements hidden. Remove the metaphysics of oppression from this equation, and what is left but a curriculum of hate that justifies aggression towards groups guilty by virtue of their skin color, class, gender, and religion? The victim category, people of color, used by adherents of the oppression creed, is itself a racist term designed to demonize its targets, specifically whites, who are the only people in the world who are not of color and therefore not victims but oppressors. The term and its usage are not grammatical English but of French provenance, indicating their wholly ideological nature. People of color is designed not only to demonize white people, but to excuse those people of color who are imperialists and dictators, run the most oppressive social systems in the world, and have historically enslaved more black Africans, for example, than have white Europeans, and still do. The term people of color defines no real-world group with common interests. The principal enslavers of black Africans over more than 1,000 years were other black Africans and brown Arabs. Black Hutus in Rwanda recently massacred 1 million black Tutsis. Mexicans are descended from Spanish conquistadors, but also from the indigenous Indians they oppressed and slaughtered. In the framework of identity politics, however, both groups are people of color, therefore, by definition, oppressed by whites. If the term people of color isn't racist, what is? Identity politics is not only racist, but totalitarian. It encompasses and defines the totality of individuals and their life paths, while erasing their biographies and their individual wills, character traits, and actual deeds, submerging them into group identities. This deprives people of human agency. In the progressive view, the destinies of the oppressed are determined by others beyond their influence and control. Similarly, the guilty of the oppressors lies first of all in their genes, not their ideas, choices, and actions. The oppression curriculum explicitly states that white people are racists because they are white. An abstraction called whiteness causes them to collude in an alleged global system of privilege and oppression. According to the oppression curriculum, they collude by working together to make it happen, intentionally or unintentionally, consciously or unconsciously, by action, inaction, or silence. In other words, being racist oppressors is their unalterable status. In the hands of ideologues, white privilege is one's essence regardless of what one actually does or suffers. Nothing that one achieves is the result of one's actions or talents, but is the unearned fruit of being white. According to the oppression curriculum, white people privilege is unearned access to the resources that enhance one's chances of getting what one needs to influence others in order to lead a safe, productive, fulfilling life. You might try telling this to all the white people who lost the opportunity to attend elite universities, qualify for scholarships, or secure jobs and promotions because of affirmative action programs that discriminate against them on the basis of race. The dangerous fiction of white skin privilege. Forms of oppression is a reliable guide to the basic architecture of identity politics and its racist agendas. Under its aegis, individuals disappear, along with their achievements, abuses, failings, prejudices, attitudes, and actions. Both oppressors and oppressed are viewed as passive objects of racial and gender powers, influences beyond their control. All the dimensions of human intentions, actions, and interactions are flattened into crude and narrow categories whose moral implications are predetermined. And the bottom line is that white people are condemned for imaginary sins, while people of color are exonerated for presumed victimizations. The informational website Wikipedia, which reflects commonly held opinions and prejudices, defines white privilege this way. White privilege, or white skin privilege, is the societal privilege that benefits people whom society identifies as white. It then explains societal privilege this way. In anthropology, privilege is a special right, advantage, or immunity granted or available only to a particular person or group. But the inconvenient fact is that for nearly 60 years, it has been illegal in America for any social institution or authority to grant special rights or advantages or immunity to any particular person or group based on skin color, unless one is black or brown or the member of a victim group specifically designated to receive affirmative action benefits, a clear violation of the 14th Amendment. In short, white privilege is a fiction convenient to the left, whose real agenda is to demonize white people and remove from all others responsibility for what they do or fail to accomplish in life. White privilege is not an analytic category. It is a weapon designed to cripple and destroy white people who get in the way of the leftist agenda. The website tolerance.org is a resource for K-12 teachers put together by the Southern Poverty Law Center, a notorious left-wing smear site and blacklist organization. An article on the website titled, "What is White Privilege Really?" explains the invisible powers of white privilege this way. It seems logical that a person should have the chance to prove themselves individually before they are judged. It's supposedly an American ideal, but it's a privilege often not granted to people of color with dire consequences. For example, programs like New York City's now abandoned stop and frisk policy target a disproportionate number of black and Latinx people. The suggestion that black and Hispanic people are targeted for their skin color is false. The policy would have been illegal if it were true. Stop and frisk was originally a New York law enforcement practice designed to make random checks for illegal concealed weapons, and thus to prevent potential robberies and worse. It was instituted by conservative Republicans and subsequently canceled by left-wing Democrats, who claimed it was racist. To make stop and frisk a racial issue, opponents of the policy, such as tolerance.org, suppress the details of its rationale, and in particular the profiles of the individuals it was designed to target. In all their analyses, identity politics ideologues are careful to eliminate the individual details, including the motivations for policies and their specific applications. The purpose of this is to bring into focus the racial morality play of the left: black, victimized and good; white, privileged and bad. The racial categories obscure from view all the actions of individuals that might account for the disproportionate number of blacks and Hispanics affected by stop and frisk. For example, 97% of the homicides in New York are committed by blacks and Hispanics. While blacks constitute only 23% of the population, they commit 70% of the armed robberies. By contrast, whites commit only 4% of robberies. In other words, the stop and frisk policies that disproportionately discover concealed and illegal weapons among blacks and Hispanics have an explanation that is behavioral, not racial. So-called white privilege is a reflection of the fact that whites are only 3% of the homicide problem and 4% of the robbery problem. Therefore, law enforcement officials are sensibly less interested in them. The privilege is not a privilege, it's earned. On the other hand, 87.5% of the homicide victims of blacks and Hispanics are other blacks and Hispanics. Taking into account all these statistics, The now-abandoned stop-and-frisk policy is realistically seen as a privilege for the black and Hispanic citizens who are the potential targets of lethal criminal behavior and were therefore favored for protection. From the vantage of the black and Hispanic victims of criminals carrying illegal weapons, the elimination of stop-and-frisk is actually racist. Of course, it is quite possible that the procedures were unjustly applied and that some people who were stopped did not fit the profile of suspects whom police were supposed to search, and perhaps the practice was so intrusive that it was not worth the gains. But this still would not be a case of white-inflicted injustice, let alone oppression, since the majority of New York City's police officers are black, Hispanic, and Asian minorities, and the rationale for the law had nothing to do with racism. The effect of the identity politics creed is to remove all the complexities of the real world in favor of a policy that meets ideological criteria to satisfy progressive hostility to whites. It is proposed as a measure to protect minorities, but actually results in adverse consequences for the minority victims of inner-city crime. The myth of systemic racism. Most arguments offered by proponents of the white skin privilege doctrine depend on attributing all disparities between races to systemic racism rather than the habits, attitudes, and actions of individuals. For example, the Tolerance.org article tells us that the ability to accumulate wealth has long been a white privilege, a privilege created by overt systemic racism in both the public and private sectors. Typically, Tolerance.org doesn't actually identify any overt racist policies or acts which are illegal under American laws, nor does it examine any of the individual behaviors that lead to wealth accumulation. Its premise that the ability to accumulate wealth is a white privilege would be news to Oprah Winfrey, daughter of a sharecropper raised in segregated Mississippi, whose net worth is $2.9 billion, or to billionaire basketball player and TV host Shaquille O'Neal, billionaire icon Michael Jordan, centimillionaire LeBron James, hip-hop mogul, clothing magnate, and outsized celebrity Sean P. Diddy Combs, mega-millionaire entrepreneurs Tyler Perry, Robert Johnson, and Kanye West, or any of the many other blacks who have managed to accumulate tens and hundreds of millions of dollars in a single lifetime. Inherited wealth is often invoked as an insuperable advantage, a privilege that allegedly whites alone can take advantage of. But 80% of all millionaires are first-generation millionaires. In other words, they earned their good fortunes. On the other hand, 70% of black children are born out of wedlock, a nearly insuperable disadvantage thanks to a policy of the welfare system inflicted on America's poor by Democrats, which cuts off welfare benefits for homes where a father is present. All other factors being equal, including race, a child raised in a single mother household is 4 to 5 times more likely to be poor than a child raised in a household with two parents. Factors such as fatherlessness are generally excluded from the studies that claim the wealth gap is intractable. Attempts to introduce such uncomfortable facts are summarily dismissed by advocates of the systemic racism myth as blaming the victim. The advice offered to teachers on the Tolerance.org site is to encourage whites who are said to be unconscious of their racism to have compassion for the black people they unwittingly victimize. Racism, according to the self-proclaimed anti-racists, is unconscious and invisible. Otherwise, of course, it would be prosecutable under America's existing laws. Because there are only a minimal number of such prosecutions, ideologues are forced to rely on the preposterous claim that white racism is pervasive but unintentional, simply a product of being white. It is part of the alleged structural oppression that afflicts everyone who is non-white. According to the white privilege ideologues, blacks can't be racist. The actual rationale for this absurdity is that recognizing black racism, which is the central creed, for example, of the Nation of Islam, is too embarrassing to their claims. The formal argument they propose, that blacks have no power, is so ridiculous that they don't even bother to present a case for it. Since it's directed against whites, merely asserting the claim is sufficient. Because the allegedly systemic problem of racism cannot be attributed to overt racists and is thus invisible, it has to be explained to people by a multi-billion-dollar industry of diversity experts whose arguments are as elaborate as they are malicious, focusing on collectivities like people of color while ignoring the individuals within the collectivities. If blacks as a racial group earn less than whites, that must be the result of racism. But if the majority of blacks have actually been able to enter the middle class, what accounts for the failure of inner-city blacks to do the same? If this disparity were mainly or exclusively a matter of race, how to explain the successes of the black majority? More likely, it is individual bad choices, including absent fathers through multiple generations, off-the-charts crime rates and drug abuse that have shaped the circumstances of those still trapped in poverty. If white racism and white privilege are the answers, how is it that Asian Americans from India and Japan are richer ethnic groups than whites? The effect of a cultural Marxist outlook is to create guilt on the white side of the scale and grievance on the black side, leading to emotions that can be corrupting for both. The alleged oppressors are burdened with a guilt that may be unconnected to anything they have actually done, but can do serious damage to their judgments nonetheless. It can, for example, encourage the abandonment of merit standards because they are alleged instruments of structural racism, while promoting tolerance for behaviors that are destructive to the very individuals they may be seeking to help. Nobody argues such drivel where athletes are concerned because it is obviously ridiculous. But the success of the war against standards and institutions of learning has had a devastating effect on the minorities it is alleged to protect. On the victim side, the idea that there is a system of racial privilege that is rigged against them encourages feelings of resentment, fatalism, and entitlement that can prevent individuals from taking responsibility for their behaviors and actions, stripping them of the power to change and succeed. Radical abuses of race. These problems are compounded by the fact that cultural Marxists in the university have been working for decades to persuade Americans that an elaborate structure of intersectional oppression organizes society into a series of overlapping hierarchies that only a social justice revolution can correct. Intersectionality theory was the brainchild of a radical leftist, Kimberly Crenshaw, a disciple of the founder of critical race theory, Harvard professor Derek Bell. Critical race theory is a radical legal framework.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.